Well, good morning, everyone. Stand up. Let's worship. It all comes down to this, what you require of me, of my neighbor as myself, and you above all things. Act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you, God, in all things, in all ways. Walk humbly with you, God. It all comes down to this.
Oh, my soul, what a beautiful day, what a beautiful day. God, we thank you for this beautiful day. We praise you this morning.
You are with me. What can separate us? You are for me. What can stand against us? Your love, it won't let go. I know it won't. Darkness. Shadows have no power over me. Fear is empty. Shame has no authority. Your love, it won't let go. I know it won't. I know you. Your plans for me. I know your thoughts, your plans for me are good. I know you hold my future and my hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
Lord, to be able to make those declarations so boldly just speaks to the depth of the truth of your very presence in our lives. We know we've experienced you right in the midst of the sweetest times in life, the greatest joys, and in the midst of the deepest, most bitter grief and sadness and sorrow. You have been with us, and Lord, it enables us to continue to praise you regardless of circumstance. Right in the midst of our grieving, right in the midst of our celebrating, we praise you because you alone are worthy. You are faithful. You are gracious and merciful and kind. And so, Lord, this morning, as we have had the joy of just being able to sing your praise, knowing that you inhabit the praises of your people, we invite you, Lord, to continue to move amongst us as we spend time in your word. Speak to our hearts, soften our hearts, soften our hearts, that we might be changed, that we might leave differently than when we came in, for your glory, for your name's sake, for the sake of our families and the lives of the people around us. Have your will in your way, we pray. In your name, amen and amen. Good morning, friends. Thank you. It was like the one friend I have in the room responds and the rest of you just leave me hanging. So good to be with you. Find your noisemaker, whatever it might be, your phone, silence it, and find somebody close to you. Say good morning to them and let them know you're glad they're here to worship with you. Ready? Go.
Well, good morning, Foothills family. Pastor Phil here with the latest on what's happening around your church. Foothills Church is hosting a car show and cookout on Tuesday, July 13th from 6 to 8 p.m. Bring your friends and family over to campus for a stroll through the last several decades of cars while enjoying a hot dog or hamburger from the grill. Register at foothillscp.org/cars to attend or as an attendee with a car for the show. And if you don't like computers, just give us a call, 530-677-3057. Hey, fellas, do you need a day out in the sun for some fun and a dose of adventure? Join the men's rafting trip and float down 9 glorious miles of the South American River on an expertly guided tour of Class 3 rapids. Space is limited to 24, so don't wait to sign up. And for more details or to claim your spot, go to foothillscp.org/raft. Awesomely Awesome Lego Night is happening on Tuesday, June 29th from 5:30 to 8:30. Bring the family to campus for a Lego night at the movies, complete with nacho bar, popcorn, candy, and more. It's a free event and a great opportunity for you to meet and connect with other Foothills families. Register online at foothillscp.org/lego and let us know if you have a cool Lego build that you'd like to showcase in our exhibit. If your family experiences an emergency, crisis, or a challenge, please don't go it alone. Let Foothills Church know, because we're ready to help. Our Compassion Ministry has available resources including prayer, meals, transportation to medical appointments, home check-ins, and minor help with tasks. Contact the church office so we can best support you during this time. Hey, young adults, it's time to enjoy some time away from the daily grind and prepare your hearts for the coming school year. Join us August 13th to 15th at Wolf Mountain as Dave Lawson helps you dig into the Word and grow in your faith. We'll enjoy times of worship around the campfire, paintball, horseback riding, frisbee golf, and a whole bunch more on this enriching weekend of fellowship, growth, and fun. The cost is $180, and you can sign up at foothillscp.org/YAretreat. If you've missed any sermons, want to revisit a favorite one, or are looking for live stream, you can find it all online and get information on all of our upcoming events at foothillscp.org. If this is your first time gathering with the Foothills family, we are so glad you're here. Welcome. Please let us know that you were here by filling out that Connect card that's in the chair pocket in front of you. And don't forget to take that card to the welcome booth on the patio, as we've got a gift that we'd love to give to you as our thanks for your joining us today. Well, that's all from me for now. Make sure you grab your cell phone or other noise-making device and set that baby to silent so it won't disturb you or those around you, and enjoy your time together in God's Word.
At this moment, God is looking for selfless men and women. He can make instruments of his purpose. The story of Moses.
Well, good morning, Foothills Church. Good to see all of you. Thanks for being here. Let me say a word of welcome to those who are joining us in our online community. Always great to have you guys tuning in from wherever you are. We hear from now and again from folks who are tuning in from all different kinds of places, and we're just grateful that you've taken time to do so. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to pull them out. We're going to be in Exodus chapter 7 and 8 today, kind of taking another chunk out of the life of Moses and his leadership, selfless leadership that we've been examining over the last several weeks. This morning we step into one of two of what I think are probably the most often thought of kind of stories when we think about Moses in Egypt. We think about 10 plagues, right? And then we think about the splitting of the Red Sea, right? And then we think about Charlton Heston, right? But today we're stepping into the story of the 10 plagues, and we won't go through all of them, but we're going to start there. The wild and epic account of these incredible plagues on the nation of Egypt and on Pharaoh. But before we step into them, I want to draw your attention to a few key realities, let's say, that are at work. In fact, I'm going to be wanting you to be watching for these as we step through the initial couple of plagues. And I want you just to be kind of mindful of these realities that are in play as we work through these plagues over the next couple of weeks, all right? The first one is this, that none of these plagues were plan B. They weren't God's plan B. God predicted they would occur. They were not kind of, you know, last minute audibles. Oh, he hardened his heart again. Now what am I going to do? Well, maybe I'll do this or what. He knew from the very beginning. Back in the burning bush scene in Midian, God was very clear how it would all take place when he said, "But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go," right? Again, in Exodus chapter 4, verse 21, when Moses was now on his way back to Egypt, God repeated to his servants what the outcomes would be. The Lord said to Moses, "When you return to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders I have given you the power to do." God knew Pharaoh's response would be what it would be, and he knew that it was going what it was going to take to break him. The plagues were as much a part of God's divine plan as calling Moses was a part of his plan. And I think it's good for us, and this is the reason I want to just call it out at the beginning, just raise our awareness to us. It's good for us to be reminded now and again that God always, always has a plan. And as we learned last week, because of who he is, God says, "Because of who I am, I will always do what is best for you." Because of who I am. So born out of my character and who I am, I will always do what is best for you. This is why Jeremiah 29:11 is such an important verse to hold in your heart, at least to be aware of. Some of you have committed this one to memory. "For I know the plans I have for you." I know he knows you. He knows you. He knows you better than you know you. He knows you and he knows the plans he has for you. And then it says, "Plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope in the future." Because of who he is, he knows and will always do what is best for you. So we can be encouraged by this. What is about to unfold in these plagues was part of God's plan from the beginning. He always has a plan, and his plans are never thwarted. And as we learned last week, because of who he is, it will always be in your best interest, right? The second key reality worth noting is that each plague was specifically a judgment against the Egyptian gods. Exodus 12:12 tells us these plagues were a judgment on the gods of Egypt. So they weren't just random things to annoy Pharaoh or annoy his people. They were very specifically the Hebrew God showing everyone who was superior. From the staff that turned into a serpent and then ate the serpents the magicians produced, to the Nile, which turned to blood, to each one of the plagues, each plague showed the superiority of the God of the Hebrews over the God of Egypt, the gods of Egypt. And this reality really did two things. When you stop to think about it, this reality first woke up the Egyptians to the superiority of Yahweh, the God of the Hebrews, and demonstrated his power to them over and over and over. It wasn't like a fluke. It wasn't like a one-time thing. Over and over, the word and will and plan of the God of the Hebrews was superior to the Egyptian gods. On the other side of it, it encouraged the Hebrews as well. It revived and emboldened and strengthened the faith of the Hebrews. This was needed because, as you can imagine, after years and years of living in Egypt, under the pomp and circumstance of the Egyptian culture and the exaltation of their gods, the Hebrews' faith had been assaulted and weakened. The plagues then display a kind of wonder and superiority of their God once again. It reminded them that the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob was the superior God of the universe, and there was no other. And he was their God, and he was about to deliver them from captivity. A third key reality I want you to be aware of is each plague we will see reaches all the Egyptians. But the Hebrews, but Israel was spared the worst. Israel was spared the worst. The whole nation and the whole region of Egypt suffered under result of Pharaoh's calloused and obstinate response to the Lord. And as you scan over the plagues, you often will see the word, you know, all the land, all the livestock, all the men, you know, all the beasts, and finally, all the firstborn. That in and of itself is a kind of leadership lesson, friends. Godless leadership brings consequences to all those under that leadership. All of Pharaoh's people suffered greatly because of his stubborn heart. Now, the fact that Israel also had to endure some of the plagues, I think there's a lesson in there for us as well. Freedom comes at a cost. It's never free. It always comes at a cost. In addition, Israel, I believe, needed to experience the mighty hand of God in order to sort of rekindle their own passion and motivation to follow him where he was about to lead them. But at the same time, God shielded the Israelites from the worst of these plagues. This demonstrated his authority even more powerfully, both to the Egyptians and the Hebrews. And it teaches us that God knows how and is fully capable of protecting his people through judgment. Now that reality comes into play big in conversations and of the progression of the end times as they come upon us. God knows how to preserve his people through anything, friends. So however your sort of sequence of events happens in the end times, everybody has a little bit of a different flavor. No matter how it rolls out, know that God is able to preserve his people through anything. A fourth key reality I want you to be aware of is this. The plagues were required to break Pharaoh's hardened heart. The plagues were required to break Pharaoh's hardened heart. Pharaoh was an incredibly stubborn dude. The pride of his person, his position, his title, all of that made his heart titanium tough against surrendering to God's will. You remember during our humility series, we talked about petri dishes in our lives. These are areas of our lives that allow pride to grow more easily. And we talked about one of them being power and position and authority and titles and things like that. That's part of what's going on for Pharaoh. The only way God could gain his attention was by dealing out these devastating plagues on everything he held dear. Remember last week we heard Pharaoh's response to Moses' request to leave, his first response, "Who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I don't know the Lord, I will not let Israel go." When you encounter someone with a hard heart, you have to meet that person with an equal or even more tough love, right? When their hearts are hardened and tough, you have to meet them with an equal or greater tough love. And that's exactly what God did in dealing out the increasingly intensifying plagues. Now, in each of the first five plagues, what we notice is that the text tells us, you're going to see this in a few moments, Pharaoh hardens his own heart. It says it over and over, and Pharaoh hardened his heart. And again, Pharaoh hardened his heart, right? So he hardens his heart just as God predicted he would. Then with plagues six and following, the text says, then it switches and it says, and God hardened Pharaoh's heart. This has led to a lot of debate and conversation, makes people scratch their heads. What's going on? How could God hold Pharaoh accountable if God's the one hardening his heart? Those sorts of questions. So let's talk about that for a second. First, I think it's important to notice that the text tells us that Pharaoh hardened his heart during the first five, but God hardens it to the last five. So 50% of the time it's Pharaoh, and then it switches, and now it's God hardening his heart. I think the best way to think about this and to understand it is to understand that initially, Pharaoh is making choices and hardening his own heart, increasingly so as the plagues go on and as they unfold. And then when his heart reaches a kind of level of hardness, God acknowledges, if you will, his repeated stubborn refusal and basically then confirms it and acts in judgment against it. So I came to this conclusion, or I'm thinking this way, because of a couple things I know about God. First, God in his essence and character is compassionate, loving, slow to anger, eager to forgive, and maintains a posture of mercy and grace towards the human heart. That's always his default. Peter even tells us that he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. That's the posture of his heart. The Bible's also clear that God never leads anyone into evil or leads them into temptation. The book of James makes it clear when it says, "But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed." See, God's not doing that. You're doing that. I'm doing that. Then it says, "After desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's full grown, gives birth to death." That's the sequence. It is also true that while God is compassionate and merciful and patient, as I've just said, there comes a time when your rebellion from him hits a kind of point of no return. The Bible speaks about God's availability of mercy and grace and forgiveness and salvation. The Bible speaks about God's availability in these ways as a kind of window of opportunity. You need to be aware of that. It's a window of opportunity. This is why the prophet Isaiah says to us, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Draw near to him while he's near." See? Finally, when that point of no return is reached, God gives the person over, the Bible teaches us. God gives the person over to their own stubborn desires. In other words, they They stubbornly resist God, and God finally gives them over to what they want, and he pulls back from them and releases them to the judgment and consequences of their stubborn rebellion. Proverbs 29:1 says, "Whoever remains stiff-necked after many rebukes will suddenly be destroyed without remedy." This is sobering. I get it. But this is important for us to understand. Probably the best place we see this sequence happening is in Romans chapter 1. It's very descriptive. Romans chapter 1, I'm going to put it on the screen for you so you can look at it with me. I've got the whole text up here. "For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened." See that? You see the progression. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. There's progression language there. "And exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images to look like immortal beings, human, birds, animals, reptiles. Therefore," verse 24, "God gave them over in their sinful desires of their hearts." See? And then in verse 26, "Because of this, God gave them over to their shameful lusts." And then verse 28, "Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind so that they do what ought not to be done." You see, it's very clear. So please realize that the one who stubbornly refuses to surrender their heart to God and continues to do so will eventually come to a point where God's going to back off. Judgment of God will be permitted to roll over them. Friend, if that's you today, please hear the truth of the scriptures. Please hear the truth of the scriptures. Stubborn, rebellious men and women will bow a knee to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Best to humble yourself and surrender your life than be humiliated in God's judgment and forced to bow. Please consider that. Please consider that. So, now, for all of these reasons, when it comes to Pharaoh's heart and his hard heart, it's best to understand that as these plagues roll out, Pharaoh hardens his own heart to the point that God then gives him over to his hard heart and allows God's judgments to roll out on Pharaoh and all of his people. At that point in the story, basically let the plagues begin. Let's look at chapter 7, verse 14 through 18. As we begin, the Lord said to Moses, "Pharaoh's heart is unyielding. He refuses to let the people go. Go to Pharaoh in the morning as he goes out to the river. Confront him on the bank of the Nile and take in your hand the staff that was changed into a snake. Then say to him, 'The Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has sent me to say to you, let my people go so that they may worship me in the wilderness. But until now, you have not listened. But this you will know, by this you will know that I am the Lord. I am Yahweh. With the staff that is in my hand, I will strike the water of the Nile, and it will be changed into blood. The fish in the Nile will die, and the river will stink. The Egyptians will not be able to drink its water.'" Here's the sad part. It didn't have to happen. When Moses' staff that turned to a serpent ate up all the serpents the magicians produced, Pharaoh could have recognized at that point he was outgunned. Pharaoh could have recognized that his gods were inferior in the face of the God of the Hebrews. He could have relented and let the Hebrews go. His nation could have continued to prosper even without the Hebrew slaves. The grief and anguish and loss of life never had to take place, really. But that's the story of our sin-sickened world, isn't it? Puny, powerless humankind raises their tiny fists in the Creator's face and proudly declares, I'm going to do it my way. I know better. I got this. And untold heartache and misery, tears of misery fall. The Nile River was, you know this, worshipped as a god. It was considered basic to life itself. Well water in the region, I've learned, is contaminated and apparently remains so today. So surface water was the only safe source for drinking, irrigation, bathing, all of that. On top of it, it was the source of their food, the fish from the Nile. So God's first punch here was a body blow to the heart of Egyptian life. Verse 20 of chapter 7 says this, Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded. He raised his staff in the presence of Pharaoh and his officials, and he struck the water of the Nile, and all the water was changed to blood. The fish in the Nile died, and the river smelled so bad the Egyptians could not drink its water. Blood was everywhere in Egypt. Ew. Right? I mean, try and picture this. I know you do. You got to put our imagination caps on. Imagine the sight of it. Imagine the smell of blood and fish and rotting vegetation. How's your gag reflex? Add to that 7 days and 7 nights completely without water, basically no food either. Can you imagine the panic, the chaos? I mean, it's not like they had, you know, spare refrigerators and freezers like many of us do in our garage with some backup. This one hit them directly in the breadbasket of life. But the text says Pharaoh virtually shrugs it off. He walks out onto his portico, he looks out, he sees what's happening, he just turns around and just walks back in the house. Shrugs it off. There's a saying that denial is not a river in Egypt. But apparently, there's plenty of denial in Pharaoh. The Lord's word meant nothing to him. It was like water off a stone. So next, God chooses to send a plague of frogs. Look at chapter 8, verse 1. 7 days passed after the Lord struck the Nile. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to Pharaoh and say to him, this is what the Lord says, let my people go so that they may worship me. If you refuse, I'll send a plague of frogs on your whole country. Now watch this, verse 3. The Nile will teem with frogs. They will come up into your palace and your bedroom and onto your bed, into the houses of your officials and on your people, and onto your ovens, into your ovens and kneading troughs. The frogs will come on you and your people and all your officials. Growing up in Ohio, I've had a little experience with frogs, bullfrogs. I've seen many monstrous bullfrogs while I'm bass fishing and stuff. Did a little frog gigging one time accidentally. I was about 10, and my neighbor and I were walking around the edge of his pond, and we heard this huge bullfrog, and we said, let's check out how big this guy is. I mean, it was big. It was like, and so I spotted him, and then I looked around for like a stick. I didn't find a stick, but I found a steel T-post. Yeah. And I said, I'm going to try to gig him. And I hurled with my best Olympic javelin, hit the thing right square in the middle. Have you ever had frog legs? If you haven't, you haven't lived. But man, I can't imagine wall-to-wall croakers. I mean, the text is so descriptive, isn't it? I mean, it sounds like a Dr. Seuss book. Frogs in your bread, frogs in your bed, frogs, you know. I mean, they're in your kitchen. They're in your bed. They're in your clothes. I mean, I think if, you know, I don't know about you, but I wake up sometimes in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom and I'm thinking I'd have to like flop frogs off of me first. And then I walk to the bathroom in my bare feet and then step on that or there step on. I don't like things like touching me in the dark when I'm in bed, you know, and like moving. I don't like that. Man. Now, it seems Pharaoh might be softening a little at this point because he actually asked Moses and Aaron to pray to God to take the frogs away. Take these greasy, slimy, cold, wet things away. And so they do, and God graciously does. Wow. There's a whole sermon in itself. But as soon as there is relief, Pharaoh hardens his heart again, the text says, and so God now is forced to release the gnats. Look at verse 16. Then the Lord said to Pharaoh, or Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron, stretch out your staff and strike the dust on the ground. This is so fascinating. And throughout the land of Egypt, the dust will become gnats. They did this, and when Aaron stretched out his hand with the staff and struck the dust of the ground, gnats came on people and animals. Notice, all the dust throughout the land of Egypt became gnats. But when the magicians tried to produce gnats by their secret arts, they could not. This third plague arrives unannounced. It's interesting. I'm not sure the reason, but every third plague arrives unannounced. It just starts. I guess one thing it teaches us is that God sometimes God announces what he's going to do, and he kind of gives us some warning and lets us know. Other times he reserves the right to surprise us. We simply can't put God in a box, friends, in any way, shape, or form. Now, gnat in the Hebrew here is a word that describes a biting, stinging insect. We simply have to try to imagine how nasty this is. These are the kinds of insects that would penetrate nostrils and ears, be in your eyes. Can you imagine what an annoying crazy maker this would be? Several years ago, Sam and I decided we were going to go up and take our float tubes up and pack into a lake. And we ended up at not at the lake we intended to go because there was still too much snow. So we ended up at Red Lake, and we parked in the parking area at Red Lake. If you've ever been there, you'll understand what I'm describing. But we parked at the one end of the lake, and we wanted to hike down and bushwhack to the other end of the lake where no one usually fishes. That's a little secret, right? You never fish by the parking area, right? Right, makes sense. Okay, I might be dumb, but I'm not stupid. So we put our packs on, which had our waders, our hip waders, and our inflatable float tubes in them, and we hiked to the other end of the lake. When we got to the other end of the lake, we were a couple on the ridge, kind of up on the ridge, and so we hiked straight down and kind of bushwhacked down to the edge of the lake. When we walked through all of the vegetation right at the edge of the lake, we raised a swarm of mosquitoes. And we began swatting mosquitoes, and of course, neither of us prepared fishermen brought bug spray. So we're swatting and we're sweating, and mosquitoes are buzzing, you know, all around. And I swatted one time on my leg and killed like five. I mean, that's how thick they were. Not exaggerating. It was the worst thing I'd ever experienced. And so we decided quickly, let's put on our hip waders so at least 3/4 of our body would be protected. And because we had shorts and t-shirts on. And so we put our hip waders on and they were still swarming, and we got our float tubes out and we're trying to pump them up and we're sweating, and the mosquitoes are just like, and when we're breathing, we're sucking them in. And so we're coughing and spitting, you know, Yeah. And then one of the zippers, of course, on our flow tube was stuck. And so we're both down there huffing and puffing and sweating, and they're all over us. And it was in, they were crawling like in my nose and ears. And it was the worst. Isn't it amazing how badly bugs can bug you? I mean, I'm sitting there going, how bad is West Nile virus? I mean, what? Each of these plagues was getting progressively worse. I mean, the Nile filled with blood, I mean, yeah, it was bad, but the text tells us they dug holes near the river, like wells or whatever. They found some surface water somewhere that was untainted, so they found a way to cope. Frogs were gross and slimy and annoying, but no one got hurt, no one got bit. But these gnats pushed the people and the livestock out of their minds. The text says that the dust of the earth became gnats. Can you imagine? My daughter and son-in-law live in a little town in the southeastern corner of New Mexico called Hobbs, New Mexico. How many know where Hobbs, New Mexico is? Zero people. Good, because last service there were like four. Oh, you do? Why? Do you know that? Why do you? Okay, you live in Albuquerque. All right. Yeah. Hobbs, New Mexico, right on the edge of the Permian Basin where all the oil is. God bless, right? But it's desert and it's dust. And when they moved there, not long after they moved there, my son-in-law got a yellow lab. And the yellow lab started itching and scratching all the time. Itching, scratching, like constantly. And he would yell at him, like, stop doing that, whatever. And the dog's just constantly scratching, itching. So they took it to the vet and they ran a bunch of tests on the dog. Turns out the dog is allergic to dust. That's a problem. There's dust everywhere. You know what a haboob is? Yes. It's a dust storm. And they come blowing through and there's layers of dust on everything. I mean, it's like being allergic to air. It's a crazy maker. This is the incessant annoyance and physical experience Egypt is having. And still Pharaoh would not soften his heart. Verse 19 tells us, even his magicians could not duplicate it, leading them to declare, this is the finger of God. They get it. This is the finger of God. But Pharaoh's heart was hard and he would not listen, just as the Lord had said. Now, at the end of the third plague, before the beginning of the fourth, God intervenes in an amazing way, as I've mentioned a moment ago. From the fourth plague on, which is the plague of insects coming up, the land of Goshen, where all of the Hebrews lived, they were not touched. There was like an invisible shield over their area, and none of those insects bothered them. Is that awesome or what? I love that. This is an added layer of miracle to God's show of power. He knows how to protect his people, friends. And it increased the Egyptian intimidation factors. Like, he not only brings them on us, he keeps them from them. Ratchets up the intimidation and fear in the Egyptians and ratchets up the encouragement to the Hebrews. Never doubt it, friends. The protective hand of God is over your life. Psalm 91:7 says, 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. Your God is with you. And with that protection, the Hebrews of the Hebrews announced there in verse 22, the Egyptians begin to endure the fourth plague, the plague of insects in verse 24. And the Lord did this, dense swarms of flies poured into Pharaoh's palace and into the houses of his officials. Throughout Egypt, the land was ruined by flies. The Hebrew word for swarm means mixture. Mixture. speaking of a great mixture of different kinds of insects. Big flying beetles, spiders dropping off the ceilings, fleas hopping all over you, ticks burrowing into your skin, tiny jiggers and sand mites crawling in your sheets and your clothing, bees stinging you. The insects descended on Egypt by the multiple trillions everywhere except Goshen, the land of the Hebrews. Can you imagine the suffering of this people? I don't know if you've ever watched any of the survival reality shows on TV. Any of you admit it in public that you watch those? Yeah. You don't have to tell which one, but there's a couple that I've caught over the years, and I always think to myself, in the comfort of my living room, sipping an iced tea, go, I could do that. Until they come to the part about all the insects and the bugs and at night and things crawling on them and all. And then every now and then they would show like a leg or a back of somebody who's been on one of these things like for just a few days, and their skin is like densely freckled with red bug bite marks, and sometimes these things are so like overwhelming to the people that it overwhelms their immune system, like, and they shock out, or they have to tap out because they get so sick because their body's trying to fight for all the, you know, venom from all these nasty. It's intense how much bugs can bug you. And how did this suffering on the Egyptian people, how did it impact Pharaoh? Well, he initially relents and agrees to let Moses and his people go. But as soon as Moses prays to God and all the insects are gone, verse 31 and 32 says the flies left Pharaoh and his officials and his people. Not a fly remained. I mean, cleared him out like that. Hello, another miracle. His heart was still hardened and he would not let the people go. Unbelievable, right? I know, it's hard to imagine. Amazing to me that the Egyptian citizens didn't just mutiny against this hard-hearted leader that was bringing so much suffering on them. I mean, you know, storm the castle. I mean, recall. I don't know. I mean, do something. Rise up. Overflow. Get rid of this guy responsible for so much suffering. But we never read anywhere where anything like that happens. Guys, I want to pause in the flow of this. We'll pick it up next week. But for now, I want to just say this as I wrap up. If there is one overarching lesson that we seem to be getting from the plagues at this point, it might be this. It is complete and utter insanity to fight against God. And I know most of us aren't living lives characterized by a rebellion against God. But please realize, the longer you resist God's will in any area of your life, the longer you resist God's ways in your life, the more struggle and heartache you invite in. It's just a principle of life. It's just a law of the universe, you could say. Pharaoh could have spared himself and his people untold misery had he just surrendered his heart, said he just humbled himself and surrendered to God's will. So my question for you today, and for us to sort of stir in as we start this next week ahead, my question to you is this: is your life surrendered to God? Is it fully surrendered? Are there any pockets of your life where you've not been able to turn it over? You've held it back. When we hold back areas and we don't surrender, we open ourselves to heartache and misery. It's just not worth it. Sometimes we can recognize there's a part of our life and we know we need to surrender it fully, but we're just not willing yet. Ask God to make you willing to be willing. He's loving you well. He's pursuing you. He wants your full surrender that he might breathe the richness of his blessing in all of your life. And so I would encourage you, surrender to him fully. Today's the day. Today's the day. He's inviting you to fully surrender. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your text and your truth and this account of this amazing, amazing journey of your people and how you interacted and related with them and how you interacted and related with Pharaoh. And Lord, these lessons that we learned from this are so clear and so important for us in our lives. And I just ask you, Lord, just to move over us with your spirit, move in us with your spirit. Point out areas of our lives that aren't fully surrendered to you, that we might just ratchet up our connection with you, our surrender to you, just another click or two today. In those areas where we might be aware of an area, but we just haven't been able to surrender it, Lord, strengthen us, heal the pieces of our hearts and minds, our emotions that keep us attached to that. And be our deliverer, be our rescuer. Lead us into freedom in greater and greater ways. It's so good to be connected with you, Lord God. So good to have this opportunity to draw near to you while you may be found. So good to live and follow you in this arena of grace and mercy and forgiveness and kindness that you surround us with, your compassion, all of your leanings towards us. May your kindness to us continue to lead us to repentance and surrender. We love you. In your name, amen.